Israel, a land of immense historical, archaeological, and spiritual richness that formed the bedrock of the Christian faith. On this journey, we begin shedding some of our preconceived notions of the Bible and read the scriptures with new lenses.
Yeah, it's a good flight, it's not difficult.
Our tour guide, Tony, encourages us to be open to three things that would happen on this trip. The clarification, confirmation, and correction of our faith. And with that in mind, we embarked on a journey that would begin to bring to life the full reality of the world God created and the gospel that would redeem the broken.
Wow.
Are you
waiting
for that reaction?
Yeah.
Oh, wow!
It's really windy here, so I'm not sure if I can be heard, but Israel is a very, very small country, as you can see. As you can see from the maniacs behind me.
Morning, Vince. Here we are, day two. What's on the menu today?
We're here?
Yep.
The baptismal site on the Jordan River.
Yep.
So we're going to the Jordan River.
Going to the baptism.
Which is not a river.
Stream.
It's a stream.
A simple but stunning revelation occurs to me. This is all real. The Bible stories I grew up with are more than just tales. No, every rock on the ground tells a story. Every destination an invitation to reimagine what it would have been like to sit at the feet of Jesus, hanging on to his every word.
So, as I said, this would be the shore. It's small, for it's good schools of fish.
Yeah.
So, Tony just talked to us about the passage about Jesus re-encouraging Peter about feeding his sheep. And this is the passage that God, I believe, spoke to me about staying in Hong Kong after my first contract at CAIS. And here I am, my sixth year in Hong Kong, going on eight.
Woo!
Well, praise God, you listen
I'm
to God.
I'm standing on holy ground.
The Sea of Galilee is where Jesus called the fishermen disciples. It's where Jesus rebuked the wind and calmed the sea. It's where Jesus walked on water. When we think about Peter's attempt to join Jesus on the water, we often focus on how he took his eyes off Jesus, got distracted by the wind, and therefore started sinking. We think that if only Peter hadn't gone distracted, or if he had more faith, he could have been able to walk on water like him. I was reminded that the act of walking on water didn't require mere faith, but it did require a direct calling. I don't think Jesus was disappointed at Peter. Rather, he called Peter, and through both his obedience and failures that didn't surprise Jesus, God was preparing him for what was coming. Likewise, there are times when God calls us to something that doesn't make sense to us, that we're not capable of doing.
Arriba.
Mountain, I forgot the name. Mount Arbo. This is possibly a place where Jesus walked from, where's his hometown, Nazareth, to Galilee.
Mm.
And we're walking on this mountain now. It's very hot.
We're walking a 15 minute portion.
Only 15 minutes.
15.
Just lie down. You're not, I mean, unless this breaks off. We're all gonna do it. Have you done it?
I'm not gonna do it, I'm scared.
You need three things in every place on earth. So what is the most important thing in the whole?
People, water.
Yeah, people are important.
One of the most memorable places is the Nazareth village where we experienced life in the first century. we saw an old wine press, olive press, threshing floor, an old synagogue. We saw how carpenters work with wood and stones, and we even learned to weave and spin wool into threads like a Proverb 31st woman. As a person who is very hands-on and visual, I really enjoyed touching and doing all these things. Seeing it with my own eyes and experienced what Jesus experienced brought about a deep realization that Jesus is really real.
And then we were here, the Dead Sea.
Wow, look at all the people filming you.
Check out my tan.
Right.
Whoa, it's hot.
Look at this salt.
Yeah, really it'll be amazing when we look.
I'm surprised by how clear the water.
Disclaimer, I've actually never, ever been able to float like
ooh,
on my back.
Ooh, that's such
what?
A...
It's just like, just this imbalance.
Yeah, he's very bad
body,
at it.
So,
okay.
It would be a major fail if I can't even do it here.
I think I can float.
Okay, come on, honey. Try
do it gently.
So yeah,
do the Titanic,
floating in the Dead Sea was quite the experience. For some reason, Rachel and I had a huge group, along with some complimentary wine, chocolate, and fruit. Being the good friends we are, we of course shared it with the rest of the crew. Oh Lord, I have come to you for protection. Don't let me be disgraced. Save me, for you do what is right. Turn your ear to listen to me. Rescue me quickly. Be my rock of protection, a fortress where I will be safe. You are my rock and my fortress. For the honor of your name, lead me out of this danger. Many who spend time here in Masada walk away impacted by the story told by Josephus of the men, women, and children who chose to die free rather than be enslaved by the Romans. There is historical debate about this event, but undoubtedly, many across the centuries have looked to fortresses like Masada as a source of strength. David pours his heart out to God in Psalm, asking God to be his fortress.
Some of the most special moments for me on this trip were in the desert region surrounding the Dead Sea. Unlike most of the crowded and touristy holy sites you visited, being in the desert gave you a sense of vulnerability and solitude. We learned that the Hebrew word for desert, midbar, comes from the root word ledaber, which means to talk. Because in the desert, there's no one else to talk to but God. It was here where King David spent time in hiding from Saul, and wrote some of his most famous psalms. There were many moments where the psalms came alive for me. During a hike through the En Gedi oasis in the sweltering heat, I got a taste of how David described his soul's longing for God was as a deer pants for water. Because even the sound of running water before we even saw it gave me a huge sense of relief. It's not a comfortable place, but being in the desert is a humbling and necessary part of the process God takes us on
to recognize who he is, our need for him, and his nearness to us, even in that place.
So the ladder was left by some kind of like renovation worker. And then, but to move anything here, because it belongs to three churches, they all need to agree. But they don't agree. It's been there for 200 years because of a disagreement.
Visiting the Garden of Gethsemane was very special to me because of the journey that Sam and I went through when we found out he had a brain tumor back in 2017. We had countless people praying over us, telling us to have faith, and some even promised that God would miraculously remove the tumor. And when he didn't, I wrestled with the feeling like I didn't have the faith that could move mountains, and was exhausted and feeling like I had to achieve what seemed to be this unattainable and fearless faith in order for God to be pleased enough to act. Then I remember the night Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane before he was arrested for the fulfillment of dying on the cross for sinners. Jesus, the perfect Son of God, prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup be taken from me." Jesus was afraid. Being fully God and fully human, he understood the trial before him and still struggled. He could have asked the Father to deliver him, but he chose to submit and pray, "Yet not my will, but yours be done." And it was in this that I placed my hope when Sam went into surgery, that Jesus fully understands and experienced my deep fear of death and suffering, but through his submission, we were able to gain eternal life and a hope, knowing that God always works all things together for the good of those who love him.
Our adventure continues on the Jordanian side of the border. Where's our tour guide? This is not a historical site. Behind us is our...
See, we're in a village.
Is our resort.
A 5-star village.
Apparently it's 5 stars.
And your left or your right?
Okay, see you on WhatsApp.
We spent only 2 days in Jordan, most of the time on the road. Was it worth it? Yes. Just check this out. We concluded our trip by spending a couple more days back in Israel, and I was reminded of a saying that goes, "We travel initially to lose ourselves, and we travel next to find ourselves." In a place like Israel, I can't help but notice that so many travel here not only to lose themselves or to find themselves, but they travel with a desire to encounter the Almighty. All such journeys require a destination. Where does this journey lead you? This journey of ours and of mine has brought us closer to Him, to the One who no longer resides in temples made by men, but in the hearts of those who love Him and have received Him.
No matter what I have, Your grace is enough. No matter where I am, I'm standing in Your love. On the mountains, I will bow my life to the One who set me there. In the valley, I will lift my eyes to the One who's
This is amazing.